I'm Ben Lackey, I'm with DataStax. I lead the partner architecture team at DataStax, and we do integrations to things like different cloud providers, including Google.
I'm Ravi Madasu. I'm one of the program managers in the Google Cloud Platform. My focus is particularly Cloud Launcher, so I work with a variety of partners, such as DataStax, to make their products available in the Cloud Launcher. Okay. Today, we want to demonstrate how to run DataStax in Google using the launcher. If we have time, Ben will also be able to show you how to deploy DataStax on Google Container Engine. So the talk is divided into two parts. One is the demo part that I just mentioned. The other part that I wanted to do is give you an overview and the benefits of Google Cloud Platform. Just by the show of hands, how many of you are already familiar with or using Google Cloud Platform? Good. OK, we have a few of you. So bear with me if the things about Google Cloud Platform are already familiar to you. I'll try to quickly wrap it up so that we have more time for Ben's demo. Make sense? All right. So Google Cloud Platform comprises of varieties of products and services in the areas of compute, storage, data and analytics, machine learning, and networking. All these services have REST APIs, and you can also access them through command line interface as well as Cloud Console. For the benefit of this presentation, I wanted to highlight a few areas that are relevant. Okay. One is a compute product. We have three main compute products: Google App Engine, Google Compute Engine, and Google Container Engine. So the question is, which one do you pick? Well, it depends on your needs. If you want a highly customizable compute environment that you control and you manage, then GCE is your choice. You can deploy VMs, you can configure them, you can install your favorite software, and then you can manage the operations. On the other end of the spectrum, let's say you wanted to focus more on developing application features and do not want to be bothered so much about managing the application environment, auto scaling, then Google App Engine, which is our platform as a service product, is your best bet. Now, Kubernetes, GKE, falls somewhere in between. It gives you the control and flexibility. At the same time, allows Google to take care of some of the management features. In addition to the compute, Google has really robust data and analytics products. The first one I want to highlight is BigQuery. It's our data analytics warehouse. You can store really large amount of data and also query them really quickly. The next product that I want to highlight is Dataproc. If you're running big data pipelines using Hadoop and Spark, Google offers a managed environment to run the same. And specifically, if you're running data processing steps, you also have an additional option of using Google Dataflow. So in addition to the data and analytics services, recently we added machine learning as the new product family. Using the Google machine learning APIs, you can get predictive results in speech, vision, or translate. If you still want to use your own data to build machine learning models, we can help you with that as well. Now, in addition to all this, we have Cloud Launcher. The goal of Cloud Launcher is to provide the users the ability to launch their popular and favorite application steps relatively easily, within few easy steps. I want to take a few minutes to talk about the benefits. So I want to talk about costs, the scalability, the innovation, and security aspects of our platform. Google provides per minute billing, which means you get billed only for what you use. Sustained usage discounts are automatically applied. There is no need to pre-commit certain amount of resource usage in order to get the sustained discounts. We recently introduced custom machine types. What this means is you can optimize the machine configuration for your specific workloads. So in each machine, you can choose the amount of CPU and memory you need. This also helps to reduce costs even lower. In addition to that, we've introduced preemptible VMs, which are ideal for batch processing, which can lower the cost up to 80%. And nearline storage is yet another instance where Google is providing a way to use the storage object store capabilities with somewhat reduced availability, at the same time, lower the cost even further. Now, millions of people and businesses around the world use Google Cloud Platform on a day-to-day basis. We have one of the largest networks. I believe we are the world's biggest ISP, and our capacity includes 1 petabyte per second data bidirectional traffic, which is one of the largest capacities. If you think about it, it's equivalent to millions of users streaming 4K HD video. In addition to that, Google is making a lot of investment in computing infrastructure. Just last year alone, we've invested $10 billion. And this investment is going to increase year over year. In addition to these things, we have carbon neutral operations, which means it's something that you can be proud of running your applications on Google Cloud Platform, and also a benefit that you can pass on to your customers. We also have something called live migration. Every VM that's running on hardware, at some point of time, that hardware needs to be upgraded, and the software that is running supporting the VM also needs to be upgraded. At Google, we have been able to successfully use live migration to prevent planned maintenance windows. This means there's no more downtime for you. You won't even have to know when the downtime is. We are able to successfully move your VMs from one hardware to the next and operate it seamlessly. Now, Google's track record of open innovation is very well known. Google has open sourced Kubernetes recently and is one of the biggest contributors to Apache Hadoop, Kubernetes, and Cassandra as well. Over the last 10 years, we have open sourced 20 million lines of code and contributed to 900 projects. I've had the opportunity to visit a couple of Google data centers. And I was able to see firsthand the amount of security that the place has. It's truly impressive. So not only the same level of security is available for Google applications, but it's also available for your applications that are running on our cloud. I want to leave you with three things. One, you can utilize the unique data capabilities of Google to develop qualitatively very different applications that can quickly analyze the data and give you the insights. With our no-ops development that is available through Kubernetes or GKE and Google App Engine, you can focus your teams to build application features as opposed to using them for maintenance and the management of the infrastructure. You can also have your own applications run on the same infrastructure that power rest of the Google apps. Now, before I turn the stage to Ben for the demo, I want to briefly introduce Google Cloud Launcher. As I said, we developed Google Cloud Launcher to easily make users deploy popular open source applications as well as commercial applications. The engine behind Cloud Launcher is Deployment Manager. So using Deployment Manager, you can declaratively describe the resource and the configurations, and the Deployment Manager uses this as an input to create and configure the resources in our cloud platform. These templates are available. If you use Cloud Launcher to deploy, let's say, Cassandra, you can go on the post-deployment page and access the Deployment Manager templates, which are usually YAML and Jinja files, and see exactly what's going on. You can also take them, customize them, and reuse them using the command line interface. We call it gCloud. In addition to getting started easily on the applications of your choice, you'll be able to use this Cloud Launcher to do both test deployments as well as a production-ready deployments. We also ensure that your applications that you've deployed remain in a healthy stage. If there is a security vulnerability that requires operating system to be upgraded, we would notify you immediately. Google Cloud Launcher can also be used to create more sophisticated solutions, not just single VM solutions, as you'll see in DataStax demo today. You can configure networks. You can create clusters. You can pretty much create an environment using any resource that is available in Google. With that, I turn over to Ben for the demo.
Cool. Thanks, Ravi. And yeah, mic's on. Awesome. All right, so DataStax on GCP. Three ways to do it. We've got the Google Compute Engine Deployment Manager templates Ravi mentioned. Those are available on GitHub, all Apache licensed. Do whatever you want with them. As Ravi mentioned, the Cloud Launcher bundles up those Deployment Manager templates. So I'll show you how to use that. It's a graphical GUI-based web thing to deploy a cluster. Finally, we have some Google Container Engine templates, also available on GitHub, also Apache licensed, and those will spin up a cluster running in within Google Container Engine, which runs on top of Google Compute Engine. So let's take a look at all this. So I'm going to go over here, and in this tab, I have Google's Cloud Launcher already open. And if I just search for DataStax, sure enough, there's DataStax. And there's a page kind of describing what there is there. Let me make that a little bigger. I can click launch. And here it pulls up the configuration for the launch. So it asks me a couple questions. What I want to call this thing, what zone I want to put the ops center machine in, how many nodes I want in each zone. 3 is not that many, let's make it 10. And what zones I want to deploy into. So I have 3 zones selected. I have 10 nodes per zone. So this is going to build a 30-node cluster, geographically distributed between Asia, Europe, and East US. One really cool thing about Google Cloud is that the network is globally flat. So private IPs are routable anywhere, which means your traffic's all staying on Google's network. It's not going over the public internet to propagate information between different nodes. all this stuff sitting behind the two-factor auth Google does, also really neat. So that's it. You hit deploy. This, in my experience, will take about 3 minutes to run, which I think is pretty wild. But so we don't have to sit here, I've actually pre-deployed a cluster because, you know, Julia Child approach and all these. And as I mentioned, everything's behind Google's two-factor auth, so it's not available on the public internet. So let me open up a window, make it a little bigger. And in this window, I'm going to open up an SSH tunnel to the Ops Center machine in that cluster. So we're going to be able to go see the Ops Center there. So now that we have that tunnel open, we should be able to go back here and localhost loading Ops Center. And we give it a second. There we go. So that is 75 nodes I spun up earlier. 75 in East Asia, Europe, and US. One cluster, resilient to failures, geographically distributed, and totally click-button. And we can go in and actually look at this stuff. You can see here, this is getting pretty far along. Our 30-node cluster, it looks like we're still working on one machine in the US, and Europe's baked, and yeah. So just one more going, which actually means that we could open up another tunnel to the cluster we just deployed in the Cloud Launcher. So I'm going to do that, and I'll close this guy down. But in the meantime, let's poke around this a little bit more. So we can go back here. This is the cluster I deployed this morning. This is actually the Kubernetes one we're going to take a look at in a minute. But there are a bunch of really cool things about the deployment manager here. So I can drill into any one of these machines. And since you know it's a DataStax cluster, it doesn't matter. So I just clicked on some random one. And if I click on SSH there, it opens up an SSH terminal in the web browser. So this is connecting to the machine, once again, authenticated through the Google two-factor auth, not exposed on the public internet, all nice and secure. Let's make that a little bigger. And then this has all the usual things you would expect. So there's our CQL shell. You know, I can do a describe key spaces in here, and you see the Ops Center key space and the normal other system key spaces you would expect. Similarly, back at the command line here, if I do a node tool status, we're going to get a lot of lines here in a second. There it goes. So, yeah, there's our cluster. And so it's DataStax Enterprise 5 just running natively on GCE and all the usual things you would expect. Let's see back here. So that's Ben 1. This is still building. It looks like our infrastructure's come up now. It's probably connecting Ops Center up to the cluster. That's sort of the last step. How are we doing? 450. Okay, so let's go over here. I mentioned all these deployment manager templates up on GitHub, Apache licensed, freely available. Deployment manager is really interesting. It's unique among deployment languages I've seen in that objects can be made up of Python, JSON, or YAML, and they're all sort of used interchangeably, which is really cool because you can get these Turing-complete deployments. And that's something you really need to do the more complex multi-data center deploys. So all that is available. If you want to run it from the command line, there's just this deploy.shell script. And all that does is it takes the name of the deployment and it runs it against this cluster parameters file. And we can go back here and take a look at cluster parameters. We provide a couple different examples. This one deploys in three regions, three nodes, And then the disk size here is how big the data disk is. So we're defaulting to 10 gig. The storage being used under here is Google's PD SSD, persistent SSD. So it's a network attached, extremely performant storage layer. So that's kind of the overview of the deployment manager templates. Next up, let's flip over and also up on GitHub on this DSPN, DataStax Partner Network, is a Google deployment guide. And that's intended to be some best practices, some how-tos, and things like that. So it's a good read, you know, what sort of compute to use, what kind of storage, thinking about the network and all that. There are some blog posts on all this. So there's a blog post covering the container engine and a blog post covering the recent cloud launcher launch. And then kind of the final part of our whole discussion, there's this Google Container Engine template up here. So that'll deploy, it's interesting, it deploys VMs, it deploys DataStax into Kubernetes running up on GKE. It's really a prototype implementation. What you have on Cloud Launcher and Deployment Manager is something pretty mature that you might actually be able to use in production. What's available here is much more early days as we think about how to handle storage, how to handle network inside of GKE, which adds some complexities while giving you that orchestration layer. So if I go back to here, I pre-deployed a cluster. So for the container engine, much like the deployment manager templates, we have a little script that'll do the deployments for you, deploying the GKE cluster and then deploying DataStax within that. So if I do a kubectl get pods, there's the list of pods running on GKE hosting my cluster. And within that, I can do a kubectl get services, and that'll give me a list of the GKE services up and running. And you see in this case, we've stuck a load balancer in front of OpsCenter exposing a public IP address. So if I go back here and paste this guy in, we can see our OpsCenter up running on inside of GKE here. And it's a much smaller cluster, a mere four node cluster, not one of these 200 some node behemoths. So yeah. So the question is, in the Google Container Engine case, how do you access? And what you would want is you'd want your application deployed within GKE right up next to there. A lot of the advantage of using GKE is you can use it to orchestrate not just the running of the database, but the running of the entire application. Yeah, another question back.
So the question is, if you wanted to migrate a data center or Cassandra deployment running locally into Google Cloud, can we leverage Cloud Launcher to do that? Okay.
Yeah. So if I'm understanding correctly, it's a question about a hybrid deployment.
Yeah.
So you would have an on-prem data center running Cassandra, and then you would have a GCP region also running.
Right.
And the question is how the network bridges between those.
Yeah, so I don't think you need Cloud Launcher for that. You need probably need to set up a VPN so that they talk to both these things talk to each other.
The the best way to do that I can think of would be, so the question is how to customize the deployment to be able to support this kind of hybrid model. And there's actually one customer we've done this with, I can think of. And you'd probably take the deployment manager templates and customize them slightly. You're gonna need to set up the network between your on-prem data center and your data center running in the cloud. That's one bit. And you're also gonna have to share knowledge of seed nodes between those. So you're probably gonna want some seed nodes on-prem and some seed nodes up in the cloud. And you'll need to pass the IP addresses of all those seed nodes into the deployment manager template running up on GCE. And happy to talk about it later. We've actually done that.
Before you take questions, which of these environments are ready for production? You said some are mature, some aren't.
Yes. So,
So today, when you deploy DataStax using Cloud Launcher, it is production ready. But if you want support, you have to go to DataStax to purchase support. And the license that the DataStax is under, it'll only allow you to use the development, well, for development purposes, it's free for 6 months. Okay, so, and there's not, from a Google side, there's nothing stopping you from using it as test or production environment. From DataStax side, you may run into some licensing issues that you need to work with.
Yeah, and from a purely technical perspective, the question of which you could use for production, the deployment manager templates available are just wrapped by Cloud Launcher, so functionally inside those are actually the same. And we believe those are quite mature. The GKE integration is much newer and more of a thought experiment. Looked like there's... Yeah.
So running fine. At some stage, I decided I wanted to make some changes in the YAML file, or in the Cassandra M for mature problems. Is there a way to do that?
So is there a way to change the underlying deployment manager templates and reuse them?
No, not the deployment manager, because it's there already, so I have a cluster running.
Yeah.
So the question is, once I have a deployed cluster, really how do I change the configurations of things like the Cassandra YAML file? There are a number of ways you could do that. You could script the changes if you wanted, though DataStax Enterprise has introduced within Ops Center a new feature called the Lifecycle Manager. So it's possible to import your cluster into the Lifecycle Manager and then edit the config files within this interface we're looking at here. And that's probably the path I'd take you down. So the question is around upgrades of the database. And whether or not Deployment Manager is really an applicable tool there. I don't think it's terribly applicable. I think a similar answer would probably serve you best, where you import the cluster into the Lifecycle Manager, and then the Lifecycle Manager is able to handle upgrades of the product.
So I just wanted to point out something that could be relevant. Deployment Manager is used only for creating and configuring the resources. Once the resources are configured and they're running and created and all that, Deployment Manager doesn't have, at least today, have the capability to go and change the configuration or upgrade the underlying database version. Sure.
Yeah, and there was a question back, it's sort of interesting. Can you use tools like Ansible or Chef? And you can really knit these things together. So you could have Deployment Manager invoking other configuration management tools like that you may be familiar with. Deployment Manager handling the deployments of the IaaS infrastructure.
Yeah. There was a question. Go ahead.
So the question is around the gossip protocol, and I'm guessing what you're thinking of is there is a Google snitch, and then there's also another snitch called the gossiping property file snitch, GPFS. We typically recommend GPFS. It's really widely used. It can support Google. It doesn't do it automatically, but you can pass the configs in. And it has an additional advantage that it can do things like support the hybrid deployment being asked about earlier. Is that any follow-on questions to that, or oh, good? Oh, okay. And there was.
So we don't monitor what users are doing within a VM. Okay, so we don't have the metrics of how many users are actually using Cassandra on GCP. Related to launcher, we just launched this last week. So I don't have any information to share.
Yeah, so the deployment manager integration is, I don't know, maybe a year old at this point, and then Cloud Launcher really just launched. It's actually really exciting.
Other questions?
Okay. Oh. The question is about what snitch to use. Use the Google snitch or an alternative. The recommendation we've been making is actually to use GPFS. It's widely used. You'll have the same experiences of people elsewhere. That is, of course, a subject of some debate because there are advantages to taking advantage of the self-configuring aspects of the Google snitch. Yeah.
Just wanted to know if there were any other best practices or any other thing that we need to keep in mind when we're in the Google Cloud and running Cassandra as opposed to anywhere else.
So the question is about best practices on Google Cloud with Cassandra. And we're trying to capture that in this best practices document up on GitHub here. And this is sort of the best first pass at it. If you guys are uncovering additional things that you think we should consider in that, I'd love to collaborate on that. Oh, and another one. So the question is about supporting multiple data centers within the deployments. And actually, yes, we are able to support multiple data centers. The cluster that was demonstrated earlier had 75 nodes in Asia, 75 in Europe, and 70.
I think he means AZs within
Cassandra data center,
not Google data center. So they're asking if you have your own data center to deploy on. Is that the question?
Yes. Okay, so if I'm understanding now, the question is about two data centers deployed in the same Google region.
Yes.
So that is supported. It is not, you would not be able to do that through the Cloud Launcher. However, using the Deployment Manager templates, you would just list off the same Google region twice, and it would deploy two data centers into that same region.
So, if you're using the Google Cloud Launcher, the data set version that you're publishing, which could be deployed, how soon does DataStax come from? If let's say next week they're going to launch a new data set version, is that available in Google Cloud Launcher?
So, the question, if I'm understanding correctly, is how closely do we track DataStax versions within the Google Cloud Launcher? The Google Cloud Launcher will, of course, work with Ravi to update it, but the underlying deployment manager templates all up on GitHub, all freely available. So if we don't update it fast enough, you can go fork it and you can update it yourself. We do that as quickly as we can, but we don't have any firm SLAs around that. I just got the end sign. Please come up, talk to us afterwards. Love to answer more questions.